Well, that's a good one.
Where are you?
What do you want me to do? 3 minutes?
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine. Just leave it right there.
It is live. Live, Miss Margaret.
Everybody just heard all of that.
Church. I thought about saying good morning virtual church, but the more that I thought about it, the more I realized that just really isn't that true. We're the church no matter where we're gathered, be it in the sanctuary or in our homes. But in all of these places, our God has called us to worship Him and to give Him praise. And so that's what we're going to do. We're going to sing today. And as we sing, we're going to sing from here, but we invite you to crank up the volume on your iPad or on your computer and just sing loudly with us and worship our great God and give Him the praise that He is due. And one other thing I want to invite you to do, we want to show the world that the church is still worshiping. So while you're at home, we want you to take a picture of your worship gathering, whatever it looks like, even if it's you cozied up in your pajamas with a cup of coffee. We want to see a picture of your worship gathering. And we want you to share it either on Facebook, on Instagram, or Twitter with the hashtag HopeAtPresence. Showing the world that no matter what, the church will still worship. And so we're going to sing now. We're going to sing All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. We're going to worship our God because He is worthy of our praise.
Thank you.
Church online. Today, if you join us online, we want you to know that today is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. There is hope in the midst of confusion. What we're experiencing in our world is unprecedented, and for most of us, it's unexpected. And who would have thought that our country would have come to a grinding halt, but an opportunity as well to pause. But in sweeping fashion, our world is going through this global crisis. We want to acknowledge that, but we also realize that we have a big God. And despite the questions, the bewilderment about where the future lies, we still know that God is our hope. He is an ever-present help in times of trouble. And so this morning, we want you to forget about your worries and cares. We want you to forget about all your anxiety about tomorrow and focus on the God who loves you, the God who loved you enough to die for you. And we need not worry. The Bible says, casting all your cares upon him, because what? Because he cares for us. And we know that for you. God is still on the throne with you today. This is a word of announcement. Obviously, there's a lot of the things that are happening. We have none of our regular ministries operating. Our regular Bible studies, our Awana program, a lot of the things that we do throughout the week have been put on a hiatus for just a short time. And we are going to keep you up to date. After March 31st, we're going to tell you what our plans are. But right now, we're trying to just offer and show the love of Christ by being safe. We want to be safe, we want to protect everyone, and we want to do the best that we can to be good citizens. So we just want you to know that this too shall pass, and we're excited. So you keep praying as God continues to work, and God continues to do what he's doing, hopefully in the hearts of many people. If you're online today, maybe God brought you to this place for the very first time online. We hope that you'll be encouraged. And we're going to continue on with our service. We want to continue on with worshiping God. I pray that, this time will just be life-changing for you.
No matter what we're facing, we serve a God who is with us and who will never leave us. Who will have life everlasting. So let's continue to worship him. All my life is in your hands. assures us that nothing, nothing will ever pluck us from the Father's hand. And Paul reminds us of that in Romans 8 as well, saying that nothing could ever separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. So, amid uncertainty in the world, we can rest assured that our God, who promised, is faithful, and that He is in control, and He will never lose His grip on us.
Through the storm, oh, Then you picked me up.
Thank you, Skylar. That is the truth. We are washed by the blood. If we're believers in Jesus Christ, the blood has been applied to every stain. The Bible says that once we were red like crimson, and now we are white as snow. Isn't that a wonderful thing to know that we are His because of the work of Christ? And we're so excited about that. Well, I have to tell you, this is a new experience for me. There are some disadvantages to having an empty audience, and then there are some advantages. One of them is I will not get any tomatoes thrown at me, because there's no one to throw them. But I feed off the energy, so maybe somehow out there you guys can feed me some of your energy. That would be great. Today we're going to get back into our series. We took a little hiatus, now we're back into it. We're studying in the book of Ezra about starting over. And, you know, starting over implies that we stop, right? You start, and then something happened, and you stop, and then you needed to start over. Starting over also implies that perhaps you didn't stop under the best of circumstances. We all face different things that happen in our life, and I guess that the word we would use for that is the word failure. And there's nobody that hasn't had failure in their life. Some of the greatest people that we look at as icons of success had failure in their life. You look at Thomas Edison had 9,000 experiments before he was able to figure out the light bulb. Walt Disney, another great guy. Walt Disney was a creative genius. I mean, we would call him a dreamer and an entrepreneur and just a wonderful example of success. But Disney wasn't always a success. In fact, he started a business called Laugh-O-Gram. He was told that he wasn't creative enough, and his business went bankrupt. He created this little character called Mickey Mouse, and that little cartoon sensation propelled him to then make the first full-length animated motion picture, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, which won 8 Oscars at the time. It was just incredible. And the rest is history, right? I think that we can learn from our mistakes, but you can see his success was preceded by many bumps and bruises and failures. Oprah Winfrey, who we know is a very successful movie and TV personality, was once fired as a reporter. She said these words, she put it well, failure is a stepping stone to greatness. Now that's if we learn from our mistakes. Let me ask you a question, though. I want to ask you a real serious, sobering question of the heart. It's one thing to experiment and try different things that don't always work. But what happens when we crash and burn? Because of our own moral failure, because of our own ineptitude in doing what we knew was right. You know, there are a lot of times that things don't always go the way we wanted them to go. We try out for maybe a play, or we try to get a job. We don't always get hired for no fault of our own. But there are many times when we have failure and we have no one else to blame except ourselves. We have to look in the mirror. Now, we've been looking back at the chronicles of the nation of Israel as they attempt to start over after a dismal chapter in their history, correct? I mean, it was a nation filled with such promise, such a once great nation, and yet here they are, a nation in ruins, in slavery in Babylon, a place where it looked like all hope was gone. But it begs the question, what do you do from that point? What do you do when you look at your life and you say, what just happened? How did I get to this place? Do we just say, well, I'm just going to try to survive, and I guess there's nothing I can do about it. I made my bed, now I got to sleep in it, right? Well, it begs the question, could it be that we could be just like Disney, that we could take our failures, our moral failures, we could take the things that we've really gone in the wrong direction about, and we could turn them around, and we could learn from them. It begs the question, will we cooperate with God and learn from our past? Will we just continue to stay satisfied in our oblivion? There's an old well-worn saying that those who do not learn from history are doomed to repeat it. What we're really saying is we need to learn from our mistakes, and we make them. It's so true. We need to learn lessons of past mistakes so we won't make the same mistakes again. It's kind of a broken record sometimes. So anyways, the last time we left off, we were in the book of Ezra. We're in chapter 5 of Ezra. And if you remember, the nation of Israel started so well. They came back after they were miraculously freed from King Cyrus. He let them go back to the land, and he said, you go back and rebuild the temple, and I'll give you all the resources for it. And they started well, but they got sidetracked. And for 15 years, that project lay idle, and nothing was happening. And then along came two men, two prophets. They came along, and whatever they said really inspired them. And they knew from their words that God had called them to this, and they set their minds to complete the task. They knew that this was God's purposes for their life, to complete and rebuild the temple. And again, as we ended last time, as they were making progress, sure enough, it caught the attention of the governor over the province, over the land, a man by the name of Tattenai. And he said, okay, fellas, what gives here? What gives? I mean, people don't like it when you're starting to build a temple, and you might be a threat. And they said, hey, who's in charge of this project? I mean, you know, he just kind of went to them. And if you continue reading in chapter 5, you'll see that Tattenai takes down the names of those who were in charge, and he starts to call into question their activities. He wants to know, who gave you the authority to work on this reconstruction project? I mean, he's interrogating them, and he writes a report that he's going to send to King Darius. And this is what it says in the report. If you look at Ezra chapter 5, verse 9, it says, then he asked those elders and said to them thus, who issued you a decree to rebuild this temple and finish this structure? Apparently, because the years had passed, they didn't know exactly how this happened. Verse 10, it says, we also asked them their names so as to inform you, and that we might write down the names of the men who were at their head. He said, we want to tell you, these are the guys that are responsible for this, King Darius. And then verse 11, it says, thus they answered. Here's their response, saying, we are the servants of the God of heaven and earth, and are rebuilding the temple that was built many years ago, which a great king, that's King Solomon, great king of Israel, built and finished. So the elders are responding. The first thing they do is they declare that they are servants of the one true God, the God of heaven and earth, the God that is superior to all other gods, including King Darius' God, who also was called the God of heaven. And they're saying, listen, we're coming back to rebuild this temple that was once here, that was once sitting on this spot, and we want to finish it. And then it goes on. Here's the key verse. Look at this in verse 12. He says, but, the big B word there, but because our fathers had provoked the God of heaven to wrath, he gave them into the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, the Chaldean, who destroyed this temple and deported the people to Babylon. The Jews are telling Tattenai, the governor, what had happened. And they realize that it was God, their God, who gave them into the hands of Nebuchadnezzar. Looking back, they realize that it wasn't because Nebuchadnezzar was such a great king, or his country was so powerful, or anything like that. It was because they were disobedient
And God had permitted this tragic outcome to come upon them. It says here, verse 12, but because our fathers had provoked the God of heaven and earth. What is it that could possibly provoke a God of love to let his people go back into captivity again? It wasn't some minor mistake here. It wasn't just some lapse in judgment on these people. But the problem was these people had deliberately disobeyed God. And these actions on their part provoked or motivated God to unleash his judgment. God, in his righteous indignation, needed to discipline his children. Just like as parents, we sometimes have to do that with our kids. The nation of Israel, they didn't just make a few simple errors of judgment. They actually had become a very vile, rebellious, and a very arrogant people. When you read their history, you go back, you see that they began to worship the same gods, the same idols that they were once told to destroy. Baal, the Baal god, was no longer the enemy. Instead, he was now being worshipped, and they totally disregarded Yahweh. We read that, unbelievable as it might sound, the parents were even making burnt sacrifices of their own children. Now, how ghastly and inhumane to have wandered so far from the God of Moses as to justify the killing of their own children to a pagan idol. It's almost incomprehensible. They had truly become an abomination to God. God couldn't believe what was happening to his people. One of the lessons that we can learn from the nation of Israel, and you can learn from your past, but we can learn from their past too, can't we? One of the lessons that we can learn from the nation of Israel is don't be surprised if things go bad and stop when you stop taking God seriously. I mean, they stopped taking God seriously, didn't they? It wasn't like they weren't warned. They knew better. I mean, God told them. If you look in Deuteronomy chapter 28, God warned them explicitly that if they refused to observe what he had told them, that there was a heap of trouble coming their way. If you look at Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 15, it says, but it shall come about, if you do not obey the Lord your God to observe, to do all his commandments and his statutes, with which I charge you today, then all these curses will come upon you and overtake you. He's very clear here. He says, listen, you've got a choice to make. Who are you going to serve? Like Joshua said, he said, I don't know about you, but for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Well, a lot of these people, they had come to a different conclusion. If you look, jump down to verse 25, continues to go on and tell them, but here it says in verse 25, the Lord shall cause you to be defeated before your enemies. You will go out one way against them, but you will flee seven ways before them. And you will be an example of terror to all the kingdoms of the earth. Verse 26, your carcasses will be food to all birds of the sky and to the beasts of the earth, and there will be no one to frighten them away. I mean, that's pretty, I don't know, I mean, that's a big warning, wouldn't you say? I mean, I would be a little bit shivering in my boots, I guess you could say, if God told me that this was what was going to happen, if I walked away from him. Then it goes on. Look at verse 49. This is what he says here. Such prophetic words. The Lord will bring a nation against you from afar, from the end of the earth, as the eagle swoops down, a nation whose language you shall not understand. A nation of fierce countenance. You know, this is a prophetic description. Evidently, this was a reference to Babylon, which was later referred to in reference by Jeremiah as an eagle. The point is, God let him know what was going to happen. Even before it happened, he said, listen, I'm telling you, if you refuse to observe my statutes, my commands, if you refuse to allow me to have the rightful position of authority in your lives, then this is what awaits you. So when they walked away from God, they really were just removing themselves from their protection. They were no longer under his hand of protection and blessing. The choice was really theirs. It wasn't so much that God didn't want to protect them. They didn't want God's blessing. They didn't want God in their life anymore. So when they eventually were taken into captivity, it really shouldn't have surprised anybody, right? They knew it was coming. Their apostasy was so blatant. But I want you to think about a couple lessons. Just a couple things that maybe you can glean from this little story here. Because one of the things we see, lesson number one, that I think is so amazing to me, because you look throughout the Old Testament, sometimes you wonder what kind of a God we have, the character of God. But one of the things I see over and over again is that God never gives up on us. God never, ever gives up on us. The nation of Israel, I mean, over and over, God gave them chance after chance. He showed them mercy and patience beyond belief. I mean, if I were God, no doubt I would have given up on these rebels a long time ago. But God's love reaches beyond when others would give up. When God was talking to Moses back in Exodus, he said that he called these people stiff-necked people in Exodus chapter 32. In other words, they had a stubborn determination. They were obstinate in their disobedience. They continued in their folly till God finally had no other choice but to say enough. I mean, God hated and he persevered and he worked with them. And the nation continued to crumble and it continued to fall apart. But he held them together and finally he said, this is what you want, this is what you'll get. And it was their choice. But I get the sense in Ezra, something wonderful happens. You think it's over. No more nation of Israel, right? You think that's the end of it. But another lesson that we learn from these people is that there's always a new beginning. But lesson number two, we have to be honest. We have to be honest. It all starts there. We have to come to a place of honesty about our past. It's hard to be honest, isn't it? I mean, a lot of times we have failures. We don't even want to talk about it. And if you're filled with pride, that's even more difficult, right? To come to this place of raw honesty, quit making excuses, and just be honest about who you are. And I think that's one of the things that we can learn from our past, if we're honest about our past. A lot of times we blame everybody else for our past and all the things that happened wrong, and we're not really being honest about why things happened the way they did. Psalm 51, where David is talking there. Let me pull it up for you. It says, verse 6, he says, behold, this is David, you know, in his confessional pose. He says, behold, you desire truth in the innermost being, and in the hidden part you will make me know wisdom. I think that God wants us to get to that place of raw honesty where we quit making excuses and we can just come to him and be honest about who we are. Come to terms with it. Don't try to minimize who we are or what we've done. And the past, though, is the past. That's where we need to lead. A lot of times I think that we hang on to the past. And once we do come to terms with the past, I think sometimes we have a hard time letting go of the past. So lesson number three is one of the important things here. Because, yeah, they had a past. Yeah, they recognized it. They were clearly admitting that their forefathers brought this upon themselves. But lesson number three is very important. Is if we want to learn from our past, we need to practice forgiveness. So important for us to learn the art of forgiveness. It's a place where we come to where we no longer are going to beat ourselves up. Sometimes we need to forgive ourselves for the mess that we made all by ourselves, okay? And then we need to forgive others. There's a lot of people who hold grudges. There's a lot of people that are hanging on to the past. Part of moving on from the past, one of the lessons we need to learn is how to forgive. I have a saying, for those of you who know me, I've said it many times, and that saying is real simple. I choose to live my life looking out of the windshield and not the rearview mirror. In other words, I can't change the past. The last time I looked, they haven't invented a time machine to get back and fix anything that I did. The past is the past. It can't be undone. And I guess, why would I want to invest all that energy into the past when there's nothing I can do about it? The only thing I can actually affect is today and the future and what's ahead. I think God wants us to focus and invest in the future. We can still control our destiny for the decisions that we're going to make today. Forgiveness is an important part of that. And you need to say, God, you've forgiven me, and so I can forgive myself. A lot of us, we don't learn from our past. We figure, well, I messed up. What's the use? What's the use? Now, none of us is unique in this kind of predicament. Let's face it, everybody makes mistakes. Everybody is broken in some way. If you're listening right now to this, you have a variety of failures on your resume. The Bible says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So in a sense, every one of us has a sordid past, don't we? One that is littered with moral failings. Now, I know we all try to present ourselves with some air of respectability, but let's face it, we are really all very flawed creatures. So the question is not if we made mistakes or if we fail, but what are we going to do with those failures? How are we going to respond to failure? In this uncertain time, this is a great time for you to do a little evaluation. God's desire is that we become aware of our brokenness so that he can restore us back to him. His goal is not to shame us and make us feel bad about our sin. That's not my goal. We're all in this boat together. His goal is to show us our need and how empty our life is apart from him. Now, I'm sure with all of the events in the last couple of weeks, it's just becoming so clear just how fleeting all of our worldly pursuits have become. We can try to avoid God, and when this threat passes, we can go back to business as usual, I suppose. We can fill our life again with activity and leisure and recreation and travel, and we can go on that vacation that was canceled. But eventually, all those things end. You know that? And what we're experiencing right now is so surreal, sort of a stunning turn of events, wouldn't you say? We thought that the good times were never going to end, and yet we find ourselves ordered to stay in our homes. It's very sobering. So the question is, where do we go from here? Where do we go from here? Maybe God wants us to evaluate and look at our lives, maybe look at our past and say, what are we going to do today? What are we going to do tomorrow? Perhaps maybe it's like we talked about earlier in this series. Maybe it's some misplaced priorities that need to be rearranged. Maybe it's some areas of our life that we know that have to change. Maybe there's some things that we need to make right because we've been hanging on to the past. Maybe we're still hanging on to bitterness or anger or hatred. God says, you know what? There's more. There's a future for you. You have something better in this life than just this moment. There's a verse in Zechariah 1:4, and it says, we have it up on the screen. It says, just the first line, do not be like your fathers. Zechariah the prophet is saying, don't be like the fathers that you had who continued to walk. I mean, many of the people of the nation of Israel never were restored. Some of the people that went into captivity died in captivity. Some of the people that rebelled against God in the desert died in the desert. God says, don't be like your fathers. You know, it's never too late to learn from your past, to learn from your mistakes, and to move forward. He says, return now from your evil ways and from your evil deeds. Doesn't that really resonate with our nation, that maybe God is calling us back? He's given us a little time out, and he says, maybe it's time to come back to me. I've got good things for you. I want to bless you. I don't want to curse you. I don't want to punish you. I don't want to discipline you. I want you to know me because I have good things for you. You know, regardless of what's happening in the world, that offer is always available to you. God says, come on to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. So I don't know where you're going through. I don't know what you're thinking right now in your head, but I'm here to tell you that there's this great place, this safe place, this wonderful place of security when you're in the hands of God. God says that his sheep hear his voice. Are you listening to his voice right now? Maybe God's saying, hey, learn from the things that you've done wrong. Let's move forward. Let's focus on the future. The future. Don't get dragged into this. This sin would love to depress us and discourage us and cause despair to overtake us. We have a big God. And God says, today is the day for new beginnings. And in the book of Ezra, we see that they eventually completed that project, didn't they? They didn't let it stop them. And God worked and he continued to be patient with his children to that point. So where are you today? You need to make some changes? You need to maybe learn from your past and say, what's going to be different going forward? Well, I'll tell you, the last thing I'll tell you, the one thing I would say is, if there's anything that God wants you to do, is he wants to make sure that you are restored to him in a right relationship. A lot of us, we've been walking on the other side of the street for a long time, and God's been calling us. We've resisted. And God's saying, when are you going to get things straightened out here? When are you going to get right with me? You know, the Bible says that there is sin that is separating us because God is holy. He cannot just have fellowship. What fellowship hath darkness with light? So he wants to restore us because he loves us. God loves you so much. So in his goodness and his love, he sent Jesus to die on the cross and pay for your sins. Isn't that the most beautiful, wonderful thing that you've ever heard? That God cared so much about you that he didn't want to give up on you. So he sent Jesus to be your Savior, to pay for the sins, the penalty that you deserve, Jesus took. Isn't that amazing that God loved you that much and loved me that much? And now all he asks us to do is come on to me, receive me. The Bible says, but as many as received him, Jesus Christ, to them gave him power to become the sons of God, even to those who believe in his name. Trust in Jesus today. Say, Jesus, I want to be right with you. Forget about tomorrow. Right now, at this moment, you need to make sure you're right with God. Forget about the past. Forget about yesterday. It's over and done with. God says, all your sins can be wiped out right now. Put your faith in Jesus, and you'll be right with me. Let's pray. Father, I pray, Lord, that at this time in our life, that we would pause to just think about our standing with you. Lord, you want us to have a relationship with you. And I pray, Lord, I'm asking God that trust this week, that our greatest desire, more than anything else, is that we would know you, that we would walk with you. Because what you've done for us on the cross has made us your children if we've only come to you in faith and trust in you. Lord, I thank you for your work that makes us right. no longer do we have a past. We only have a future. And I thank you for that. In Jesus' name.
Strong wall between the two, and the answer was we need chaplains to judge.
coming